Hey guys, I'm Dani Castellano, and this is Diet Culture. For today's episode, I got to chat with Nicole Cruz. Nicole is a registered dietitian nutritionist, mom of three, wife, and eating disorder specialist. She has a private practice located in Southern California devoted to helping others reclaim their joy and find food freedom. She works with clients from all walks of life to transform their relationship with food by practicing from an intuitive eating perspective and non-diet approach. As a mom herself, Nicole's passion is to support parents in fostering a healthy relationship with food for their children. She has a private Facebook group, Joyful Eating for Your Family, and she offers virtual nutrition coaching and programs to parents. Nicole is dedicated to transforming the way we view nutrition in order to live more full and balanced lives at peace with food. We had such a lovely chat talking about rules around what it means to feed kids appropriately under the guide of diet culture, how to learn to break down that barrier to help kids be intuitive eaters and shape language around food, intuitive eating and Ellen Satter's division of responsibilities, her Fat Positive Facebook group, how parents' relationship with food impacts kids' relationship with food, and much more. Can't wait for you to give it a listen. Hi, Nicole.
Hi.
How are you doing today?
Good. How are you?
Good. It's nice to get to meet you virtually.
I know, right? It's always nice to actually get to connect like face to face.
Yeah. So I wanted to give you a shout out because I've been subscribing to your Instagram page and your newsletters that you do for a really long time. I'm in Denver now at an eating disorder care center, but before that I was doing outpatient, and I found your resources really, really helpful to pass along to parents because a lot of them would bring their kiddos in with concern about needing to lose weight and like helping them be healthy as they age. And I found your resources really, really great. And I know they helped a lot of people just from like my interaction with them. So I just wanted to start with letting you know that I think your work is really amazing.
Oh, well, thank you. I greatly appreciate that. And it's always nice to hear because sometimes in this virtual world, we don't like see that so much. So I love hearing that. So I'm glad it's been helpful.
Yeah. Yeah. So I want to hear about how you got into the non-diet or anti-diet space.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I actually struggled with my own eating disorder late high school and into college. And that's really just how it started for me. And going through my recovery is when I knew like this was something that I really wanted to do and to be able to help other people with. And so even going through my entire, undergrad and graduate program and internship and everything to become a dietitian, I knew that I would be kind of in this anti-diet space, which I don't really think was like, I didn't have even words for it then. I wouldn't have said I'm like anti-diet. I just was like, no, I'm doing something different than like this traditional thing over here. And I will be, you know, helping my clients not do that. But I didn't really know like what I would call it or anything like that.
Yeah. What was your experience like of going through that schooling after you had been exposed to the recovery side of nutrition?
Yeah, it was interesting, I think, because on one hand, I mean, I was still, when I started, I was still meeting with like my therapist occasionally and my dietitian sometimes, but things had like slowed down. Like I was in a good space at that point. So I wasn't heavy into my like recovery, needing as much recovery support. So I think it was good because I did have a sounding board to be able to talk through like some of the things a little bit. And I think I just knew that it was different though. Like there was this piece of me that maybe there were things here and there that I was like, you know, I don't know, that feels a little off. But in some ways I still thought like, that's okay for some people, but that's not what I'll be doing. And so I think I just had this divide in my head that like, that's what, you know, nutrition is, and that's okay for some people, but I'm not going to do that because I want to help this other kind of person. I didn't have this full view yet of of diet culture as a whole. It was more like eating disorder geared, you know? So it was okay. It wasn't like a really, you know, triggering experience for me or anything that was challenging in that way. Yeah, so overall it was good. I just really took a lot of things with a grain of salt. Like I remember consistently telling myself like, I'll never do that, or I'll never need to use that, or like whatever it was, because I just knew I wasn't going to be doing that kind of work.
Yeah, I think that's cool to hear of like going into it with a different viewpoint, because I certainly was very bought into all of that stuff and had my own eating disorder, but not until college. So I was very much still wrapped in it going into my first job until I started to be like, hey, what's going on here? Like, there's more to this that I haven't learned. And then once you start like seeing it, it just is, my brain's exploding because I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't believe this is real.
Exactly. Yeah. It's so crazy that once you know it's there, it's just everywhere. And I love hearing that from, you know, even clients that once they just start getting exposed to it and they're like, oh my gosh, I can't believe this. And I can't believe that. And, you know, they'll go away with friends for the weekend. And this could be, you know, women or men that are older or younger, you know, it's both things. It's like the moms that I work with are hanging out with other moms and they're like, I can't believe how much my friends talk about dieting and their body. And then on the same hand, I hear it from my college age students, you know, it's just like the whole spectrum shows you how much it's everywhere.
Yeah, very much so. I want to hear about your, I know you work with all populations, but it seems like you specifically focus on working with kiddos and parents. So I'd love to just hear about like how you got into that specific niche and just some of why you're so passionate about it.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, so everything started with my own, you know, journey and then knowing I wanted to go into that space to help others recover from their own disordered eating patterns. And so I worked at an eating disorder, like residential or inpatient actually treatment center, and then did outpatient work and was just all, you know, eating disorder recovery and just getting off of the dieting and, you know, working more on intuitive eating and built my own private practice and was just seeing clients in person and all of that. And I did that for quite a few years, actually. And then my oldest is now 9. So I now have 3 kids that are 9, 6, and 4. And I just noticed that after I had my own children and I was in these realms with parents more of seeing, you know, the snacks come out and who's eating what and parents, my friends who really had no, I feel so grateful that the friends that I came across really didn't talk much about like food or bodies or dieting. They were just very like normal with food, you know, and they always have been. But that's what was so, you know, stood out so much to me was that these moms that really had no food issues that were apparent, we all live in diet culture, so of course there's some stuff there, but no major food issues, were really struggling with feeding their children and worried about sugar and what do I feed them and what do I feed them first and am I gonna, things that I was even struggling with a little bit, like hearing the, you know, person come to the mommy and me class and talk about don't feed your child, you know, fruits first because then they'll develop a taste for sweets and like all these things that I thought, oh my gosh, you know. So I just was seeing so much stress around feeding our children for everyone. And then on top of that, even as my, you know, oldest developed to be a little bit older and a little bit older and I was in the preschool classes now and we would have the buffet lunch for them at the holiday party or whatever it was. And I was seeing parents say things like, well, my child's cut off after one piece of pizza, or just little things about, yes, you know, like the sugar that would come in. And we didn't have a lot of sugar, but it was like, oh, the one birthday that, you know, they brought the cupcakes and seeing even the way my preschool would talk about, which was like compared to diet culture, this was very moderate. I know some things are a lot worse, but even in my preschool hearing things like, oh, eat your rainbow foods first. And they wouldn't let them have more of the pretzels if they hadn't eaten some of their fruits and like that sort of thing. And so it was just all of this stuff that, oh my gosh, I was really connecting how I was seeing these things develop so early and be these similar patterns that I'm talking to my teenagers, my young adults, and my older clients about that they're thinking, you know, in terms of feeling
Yep.
guilty for eating certain foods or remembering things in their childhood about how their parents maybe didn't restrict them, but never would buy the Doritos. They had to buy the all natural, whatever chips or crackers. And just seeing so many patterns come through that I thought, you know, we need more mainstream education around this for even younger populations.
Yeah. It's so true. I find this so important and interesting just because of being on more of that receiving end. I only work with adults, 18 and older. So just like hearing things about how childhood affects people later in life, and not to put blame on parents, but just like you said, it's our culture and it just keeps cycling and cycling. And if we can't interrupt it, it's the same pain that just gets passed along. So I'm so glad that you were like, hey, I have something to say about this. That's so awesome.
Yeah, it's good. I think, you know, of course, we can't entirely prevent eating disorders or
Sure.
anything. And there's so many, like you said, there's so many components that go in. It's not just like, oh, your mom said one thing to you and now you're going to get an eating disorder, right? It's like
Yeah.
they're complex and we know that. And there's multiple factors. But what can we do in our own homes to hopefully at least shift that culture and be a different voice than what our children are going to experience out in the world? And so I see this work as being at least what we can do to prevent
Yeah.
disordered eating, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Because at the end of the day, parents want to help their kids. And so, like, if they could have a crystal ball and see how so many times just that kids watching the relationship that their parents have with food, or having food be micromanaged, or being encouraged to have to eat everything, or to not be allowed to eat some things, like, no one would want to do that to their kids. So, like, we have those two parts of, like, one, we have to dismantle fat phobia as an entire society, and also, like, trying to learn that it's actually helpful to your kid to let them eat the Halloween candy rather than be like, oh my gosh, like, you can have one piece and that's it.
Yeah, exactly. It's exactly it.
Do you get a lot of like shock from people, or is it more, I'm curious like what your day to day is like, more of people finding you because they know this is what you can help with, or do you get people kind of like what I was saying where they're like really worried about their kids and then you're like, well, I have this alternative kind of suggestion.
You know, it's interesting. I would say it's different, like it's all across the board different. So what I find a lot of are so I would say yes, there's a lot of like pushback against it to some degree, like what are you talking about, right? Like what you're the like and this is more like people that just don't understand or just want to cause a fight or like whatever, will say things, you know, that are out of line because they really don't understand. And it's this idea of like, well, you're the parent, you should control what your kid's eating, and like all sorts of things like that. So I do get that, like, this is not okay. You're supposed to be in charge, you're supposed to be the parent, that sort of thing. But what I do find about the people who actually want to do this work and are coming in to do this is they usually enter from kind of two ways. So one is either that they are struggling kind of with like the first group of parents that I was saying, that they just like want to feed their kid the right way, but they don't necessarily know what that is and they're trying to figure it out. Or maybe they're tired of like battling about food and that dessert is this like huge thing. And they're like, the mealtimes are stressful. And why does my kid ask for candy all day? And they're just like stressed out about it, right? So they come in from that lens. And then it's like, oh, well, let's look at what's really going on here and this relationship with food and how are we talking about food and serving food and that sort of thing. Or I get parents coming in who are actually already quite familiar with like intuitive eating. And they come into the space feeling like, I want to do this right for my child, or I don't want my child to have the same issues that I did. So I see it kind of being either of those, that either way, we're kind of introducing the same concepts towards, you know, a family feeding approach, which I follow by Ellen Satter, called the division of responsibility, and intuitive eating, that we come to both of those philosophies essentially, but it's often through two different doors, whether it's the parents' own relationship with food or the stress and the struggles with feeding their child. And then they get to learn about both pieces either way that they come through.
Yeah. I think it's really interesting to talk about like some of those barriers to the information on the podcast, like kind of in a safe space for people to just kind of get seeds of information. Because I think sometimes when it's stress about yourself or someone you love, it's harder to hear those messages in the moment. And so that's kind of where I'm coming from with asking some of these questions. I am curious, and also I think it's helpful for people just to hear like you're not alone if you find like anti-diet messaging abrasive, because our whole culture is like that doesn't make any sense, and that's what we're trying to shift.
Yeah, exactly. It's definitely countercultural. I think that's the real thing, and that's what it can feel like. It's challenging everything that you've thought and believed about food and how to feed and how to eat for yourself. So it can be a challenge to look at that and to feel like, oh, did I do something wrong? Did I mess up? So yeah, I think there's that piece too from people that even want to do this work. It still just feels really hard to grasp because it just like flat out feels wrong, you know?
Yeah, no, it totally does. All of the like several years that it took me to like really shift into taking this job where I only worked with eating disorders, because I was like, I need to stop straddling the fence and go ahead and dive here. I feel like hearing certain things, I was like, well, this sounds really good, but I was like, is this too good to be true? Is this like psychology, like this isn't real health? And just like I so relate to that from being in that place. I'm sure you do too, with struggling with your own eating disorder. Like it is just really tough.
Yeah, for sure. And even, coming into working through eating disorder recovery and, starting to help clients, there was still like a bit of a divide from going from that to understanding more about fat phobia and health at every size. Like that even came a little later, and I feel like that was a big jump for me too, to really when I was first introduced to it, I was like, I don't quite get it. Like, it doesn't make sense to me. I just was so, I really believed that if people could help themselves with their eating patterns, then they would lose the weight. Or, like that was a big piece for me that seemed to be missing. So that was hard. That was the part that took me more time to be like, I was kind of on the fence of this whole thing for a little while until I really started to read the books and, understand their research a bit more.
Do you I agree that that piece was difficult, 'cause it goes against everything that we're taught, and like going to the doctors and like every health article you ever read tells you that. Do you have any specific resources about that for parents of like the concept of like kids being they're being measured on their height and weight, but also their BMIs being measured too for age? And like a lot of times I was getting kids coming into me, parents asking for help with weight loss, and I was always trying to explain that we would never intentionally help a child lose weight, but to stabilize their like weight as they got taller. And now I understand still that's like not the most appropriate thing, because that's still like say is kind of helping lose weight in a sense, but that was kind of where my brain was at the time. But anyway, long rambling question. Do you have any particular resources for helping parents to understand that piece of like for kids, it's okay for them to have different body sizes too?
Yeah, I don't know that there's a ton of resources, to be honest, at this moment. The one that I do tend to recommend the most is Ellen Satter's book, Your Child's Weight Helping Without Harming. And in it, though, there still is a bit of fat phobia there. So that is a little bit tricky. I usually preface it with that there still is this idea that, we don't want them to get too fat, or, so there's this little pieces of that there. It's like, if you just do your job, though, your kid won't get too fat. But overall, I really think that the premise of it and how to feed and talking about trusting your child and allowing them to grow into the body that's right for them and all of that is still a solid resource. we just always,
Sure.
you know, there's still just those pieces of it. So there's that. I can't even think of the name yet, and I don't off the top of my head, but
That's okay. I'm putting you on the spot with that question.
that's, no, it's okay. There's a new, I haven't read it yet, but there's a new book coming out, and oh my gosh, I'll send you the link after or the information. I haven't read it though, so I can't speak exactly to it, but I'm hoping that it's really
Okay.
promising because it's new and it's by dietitians in our field that are really well versed now in, you know, health at every size and diet culture. And so it's something in the title, I want to say it might be like even like raising intuitive eaters or something like that. So
Ooh,
anyhow,
okay.
I'm, you know, hopeful that maybe that will touch on some of it more. And then, you know, in terms of additional resources, I have a free Facebook group called Joyful Eating for Your Family. And there's a lot of parents in there that, you know, are talking about this and that do struggle because their child is in a larger body and the messages that they're getting. And so they'll, you know, write in about a post about going to the doctor and what the doctor said, and you know, that they're supposed to go and lose weight or limit their food, or maybe the doctor didn't say lose weight but said, you know, keep no snacks now or keep snacks to only fruits and vegetables.
Ugh.
So it's a community at least of talking about these issues, even though it's not like a book or an exact article or something.
Yeah,
So that's what, and yeah.
that's great. We might have to collab on a resource. Sounds like
I
the
know,
we need
right?
more of them out there.
And I'm sure there's more that I just don't know about. And there's some
Oh,
great books
same.
on like child feeding and everything, but I don't know how many, you know, really address exactly what you're talking about in that sense, you know?
I'm hopeful, like you said, though, that more of these things will continue to be promising as we all that are in this particular lane of dietetics and health start to, I don't know, pave the way more so, keep going.
Exactly.
With your Facebook group, is that something that you kind of like moderate to like answer people's questions, or what would that what's that like for if someone were to join that?
Absolutely. It is moderated. It's a free private Facebook group. So you just go to Facebook, search for Joyful Eating for Your Family, you know, say that you want to join. And there are a series of questions that you do have to answer because it is, there's rules about we don't use
Oh,
certain
cool.
words, like, you know, we don't describe food as healthy or unhealthy. We don't use the O words like overweight or obese. We don't use that language in the group, and there's reasons about why and everything throughout there. And so you have to answer the questions, and then I myself moderate it, and I have three other moderators that help. The group just continues to grow. It's over 8,000 people now, which is amazing, and I'm so grateful that we have so many people, you know, in there and doing that. But there's people that come in that don't know and don't understand, and so we try to keep it as safe a
Sure.
space as possible. But it's not entirely because there's people asking questions and sharing, and so you know there is that understanding that there can be language that can be hurtful or harmful at
Sure.
times because it's a learning group at the same time, and it's hard to kind of hold those spaces to say that yes, this is a learning group, and we are a fat positive learning group. And so, how do we try to
Right.
prevent harm in knowing that I can't entirely keep it a safe space?
Yeah, it sounds a little bit safer than some of the Instagram like comment threads that I encounter from a lot of the RDs and therapists I follow, because that is hard, because it's not someone that joined that to be contributing and understanding. It's more of like, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. It gets kind of aggressive and frightening in some of those comment sections. So that group sounds really awesome.
Yeah, we try to make it that way. And there are comments that, you know, go off and we're like, oh gosh, and we try to go through and clean things up
Yeah.
and educate and delete what we need to. And
Sure.
luckily we haven't had to do it a lot, but we do kick people out too, you know, if they're going to continue.
Sure.
It's like I'm always like honestly a little bit astounded by the idea that people want to continue to be in there and push their beliefs when there's a million and 22 dieting groups you can go join. Like, if this is not the group for you, that is absolutely fine. Go join the one that fits, you know? So that's the piece. It's like, this is not the place to debate. And it's very clear. We are not here to debate these principles. We're here to help support and understand them, though.
Yeah. I try to think of that from like to get like be in someone else's shoes of like, okay, like if I saw a really toxic conversation, which I've seen before, and I've like made a comment that wasn't aggressive, but just kind of like, hey, like this is a little bit concerning, like a TikTok video that was like the what I eat in a day. And someone was like, this is promoting eating disorders. And the person was like, how? And so I like jumped in because I was like, okay, this is a good learning experience. But clearly, like the person making that video and the ones following were very much into the idea of like, okay, like eating a bowl of strawberries for breakfast and nothing else is normal. And so it's funny because like you don't know what you don't know. And it seems like we all try so hard to push the things that we think are helpful because for that person, they must think that eating less and weighing as the least amount as possible is the most helpful thing for them. And they're trying to help other people. It's just hard to like on our end of knowing, like having had an eating disorder and working in that field of like seeing that really serious harm that can come out of it and just like the general diet culture stuff. So I agree. Like it's so frustrating these, like back and forth of people just being really relentless when it's clear that this is like supposed to be a safe space for whatever the agenda is. But I don't know, that's just human nature.
It is for sure. And that's why, you know, I think we all, even moderating the group, a lot of times think, okay, what does it seem like this person is trying to do, right? Are they willing to listen? Are they trying to understand? And it's okay if you have a different opinion. Right. That's the whole point of it, right? It is okay, but then this is not the group for you. And that's the thing that's like, okay, at some point, let's recognize and move on then, you know?
Yeah, I totally get what you're saying. I recently heard someone speaking about how they want to model like a positive relationship with food and body for their child, but they're on their own like weight loss journey and like trying to navigate that. And I was curious if you had anything to speak to that in general, because I think that that can be pretty common for parents who like aren't ready to find that acceptance for themselves, but they're trying to do better for their child. But like just how that kind of still is impactful. If you have any thoughts on that.
Yeah, I think it's really challenging. And I just want to say to any parents out there that it makes sense if that's what you want to do, you know, because we live in this culture that tells you to control your food intake, to control your body, to try to lose weight, that you're never good enough the way that you are. So it's no shame or blame. It's really recognizing like you're a product of this culture too. And it's hard. It's hard to be here and not like your body and to feel like you can and should change it, you know? So I think it's first just recognizing and giving yourself some grace for being human and for wanting that. And it is impactful. And I think that we have to be really honest with ourselves that our children are going to see that and they're going to pick up on it and they're going to notice. Yeah. And we have to recognize that I'm actually a product of that. I mean, my mom never told me that I should try to lose weight or controlled my food or anything, but I watched her diet and measure her thighs and, you know, buy the Thighmaster at the time, probably the 80s or whenever that thing came out. I was born in the 80s, so there you go. So all these, you know, tools to lose weight and all the things. And so I watched it and watched it and watched it, and I never thought that I was supposed to do it until I was old enough to go, I don't think I love my body. I've noticed my body changing. Now I know what to do. That's what women are supposed to do. We're supposed to diet. We're supposed to control our body. We're supposed to try to change it. And I even remember that being younger, although I didn't have thoughts at the time of trying to change my body. I have really clear memories of thinking like, that's what women do. I will do that someday. Like that will be me at some point. Like I just absorbed that this is what I'll do at some point. And so I think that we have to remember that our children are watching and picking up on everything, and whether or not they're making like cognitive sense of it at the moment, they're still absorbing it in some form. And so I think that the work is for us to take a look at that for ourselves. And again, going back to it's your body, you have a choice to choose what you want to do with it. And my hope, though, is that you are aware of the potential consequences of doing that, and that there could be another way. There could be another way to think about and treat your body. So just to provide education so people have more awareness and choice than doing it so blindly, you know, and not recognizing it. And it's a really hard position to be in. But I think if we can always go back to what do I want to role model for my child? And I have a lot of people that, I wouldn't say a ton, but multiple people that are even in the Facebook group that don't have children yet that will say things like, I'm just listening right now to reparent myself. And so maybe we can take in some of that information that we want to pass on to our kids and really work to apply it to ourselves, because maybe it's the messaging that we never got as children about food in our bodies. And so how can we work to even reparent ourselves today and start to shift our own relationship with food in our body?
Yeah, that's so beautiful that people have shared that. I know that's like in therapy, like trying to nurture your inner child is a big like tool that can be helpful for healing. So I love the idea of applying that to like relationship with food and body. That sounds really powerful.
Yeah, I agree. I love hearing that because I think that is the work. I always say too, you know, even with the division of responsibility, which involves some structure and feeding and, you know, providing your child with a variety of options that'll be satisfying and all of that, that we can even apply that to ourselves. Like, how do we think about providing ourselves with nourishing food that's going to feel good, allowing ourselves to eat the amount we need to be satisfied, creating regular times to eat? And I'm not saying that you can never go out of that time if you're hungry or something as an adult, but just providing that structure to say, like, you deserve to be fed regularly and consistently and to take time out of your day to do that. And what is going to feel filling and satisfied and nourishing to your body.
Yeah, absolutely. That's like a really quick way to encapsulate what intuitive eating can offer with just like a couple quick pointers that I think everyone could benefit from, which is cool because intuitive eating can feel kind of like aggressive and there's a lot of opinions against it, but like who doesn't want to try and work on nourishing yourself regularly and finding balance? And really that's what intuitive eating is. It's just like it's a process, but that's like a good summation of parts of it.
Right. Through that, I think when we try to kind of decipher that from a diet or something, I always see intuitive eating and the way that we're feeding our children in that way as through the lens of like self-care, as opposed to trying to control it and have it be this external thing. But how do we set up this structure and think about food in a way that's going to provide us with nourishment and self-care?
Yeah, absolutely. And I can totally relate to what you were saying too about just like absorbing messages, because I have this clear memory of reading 17 magazine, and I was either in middle school or early high school, and there was this article about how you shouldn't eat grapes before you go to the pool because they're like bloat-inducing fruit. And I just found that so like at the time I was frustrated because I was like, oh, grapes are a nice pool time snack, but like I am supposed to have a thin flat belly. So if this magazine is telling me that I'm not supposed to eat grapes when I'm bearing my stomach, well, I guess I won't eat grapes when I'm bearing my stomach. And it's like, I was clearly not even if I was 17, I still probably would have absorbed that message at the time. So it's like really hard because it seems like this innocent enough magazine that, you know, you get a subscription to for your kid for fun. And I certainly am not blaming my mom for that, but it would be like nice if that stuff didn't exist so like predatorily on kids too. And now it's more social media, but when I was growing up, and it was more magazines and TV that was impacting.
Yeah, I know. It's hard to look back sometimes and think about that and how impressionable, you know, we were at that age and how our teenagers are now, you know, and like you said, with even more social media and everything, that it's confusing, and it gets cemented, though, these random rules, like don't eat grapes before the pool, right? Like sometimes when talking to my clients, I'm like, where did that come from? I don't know. I heard it at some point, and then it's just this thing that becomes this rule that they're supposed to follow.
Yeah, and like you said, for women specifically, like taking on that message of, oh, I'm supposed to care about having a flat stomach in the first place, so I need to be taking in this advice, and if that ever changes, I'm going to have to do something about it, because clearly that's how we define worth in our society, is being as thin as possible.
Yeah.
Ugh. It's sad. Like, I obviously love talking about these things because I'm very passionate about it, as I know you are. But sometimes I'm like, ugh, I just hate that so much, that there's so much of this still. But that is why we do the work that we do.
So true. Yes.
I am pregnant myself with my first child, and so I was really excited to talk to you, just like because I'm starting to think about these things really for the first time. Not that they've never crossed my mind, but it's becoming my reality here, and just like thinking about how to navigate some of the atrocious things that exist in the world. I feel really thankful to have like gotten into this headspace in my career and like as a person and a dietitian before bringing a kid into the world. It makes me feel just like a little bit more grounded. Not that we never make mistakes, but you know what I mean?
Absolutely. Well, congratulations to you. That's exciting.
Thank you.
Yes. And yeah, I agree. And it's really, I think about, you know, how much harder it would have been to not even have the awareness that I had. And then that's like really where I said in the beginning of wanting to bring this message more and more to the general population, even because I felt even armed with all of this information, I still was like, should I not feed them fruit first? What if they do that? Like, it still brings up all these things, because you want to be the quote unquote perfect parent. You want to do it all right. You don't want to mess up. And I mean, shortly you realize that you're gonna F up your kids left and right, and that's just part of it all. At this point, I'm like, what do I do again? I don't know. It's all like they're all screwed up, right? Like, it's just like you at some point realize you can't do that.
Oh my gosh.
And I think too, like, I mean, just to be totally honest, I think too, my stress and anxiety with my first one about all the little things. And I don't even think I was that stressed looking at other parents, but knowing how much more relaxed I was by the time I got to my third one, you know, like my first one, I was definitely more like, is this the right product? Am I doing this at the right age? Is this the right thing? Like all the things, you know, you're like looking at a manual, like trying to figure out what do I do next? What do I feed them? How do I do this thing? By the time the third one, I'm like, whatever, you know, you're screaming in Target, have fun, like go for it. Right. So it's like all the things, but I can tell even now, my oldest one is definitely the most anxious overall, like, you know, more uptight, more concerned about himself. And part of it could just be personality, but I believe part of it is my energy with all of it too, that he was soaking up from very young around, partially probably around food and around other things as well, though, you know, and I just see that. And so, you know, I think it's so hard for all of us as parents, because we want to do things right, and there isn't a perfect right way to do it all. But the more awareness that we can have, and the more that we can feel confident and just relaxed and know, like, you're not going to screw up your kid because you put you feed them the flavored yogurt instead of plain yogurt or something. That was like one thing I was concerned about, right? Like, don't put the extra sugar in the yogurt, because then they'll only like sweet yogurt and they'll never like plain yogurt or whatever it is. Like, these little things that, those aren't the things that matter, you know?
And those things are so intrusive when you're being exposed to information. So it's good to hear, like, from someone who is like, okay, my kid is okay. And like, I'm sure that's really comforting to a lot of people to hear that, just like you sharing your own experience with your kids and like navigating their relationship with food too.
Yeah, I think it's nice. I mean, I really do think that my other two are more relaxed with everything because I was more relaxed, you know, and it shows with even food, I think, like, you know, so. Yeah. And of course, like I said before, there's personalities, there's all sorts of things. It's not like, I'm not trying to say like, oh, I created whatever it is, or sure. or that we even have major issues. I can just see the little differences in everything, you know?
Yeah, it's interesting. Like, it makes you think about like why that might be or how to do things differently or recommend. Like, I totally get what you're saying with that. But yeah, I appreciate you being honest about it.
Of course.
So we've probably talked about this a good amount, but I'm wondering if you have any other advice for people who are working to leave diet culture behind, or kind of like in that space of not being sure if they want to fully, make that jump, of why you think it's something worthwhile to do.
Yeah, I mean, I think for everybody, they have to figure out their own why, you know, and why that might be important for them. And I think it's taking a look at how is your relationship with food right now? How do you feel about it? And if it feels great to you, then by all means, go for it. You know, keep doing what you're doing. Most people that I talk to that are in some form of dieting, restriction, eliminating foods, being controlling of the types of foods or the times they eat, whatever it might be, don't feel great about food or their body, don't feel like they can trust themselves, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's not to say everybody, though. Some people are like, I like to eat this way. I'm a structured person. It doesn't bother me. It's good. This is how I want it. Don't touch it, right? Like, go for it. So I think it's really figuring out what feels okay to you and how do you want that to look in your life? And so it starts with the assessment of, is this working for me or could there potentially be another way? And for you to figure that out, because I think that there is another way, you know, if it doesn't feel good to you, and that you can embrace a relationship with food that does feel good and that does feel trusting and that does feel more flexible and fluid and all the things that, you know, eating more intuitively can bring. And so I think, you know, if that's something that you're interested in terms of advice, it's about finding community at the end of the day and really getting some support. And that can be working one-on-one with someone, or that can be just finding these spaces in social media or in, you know, virtual or in-person groups, whatever's around that. You have other people that get it too, because this culture is so strong in the diet messaging. And that doesn't even just mean restricting your food. It just means trying to control your body or lose weight, whatever that is, that this messaging that we're getting is so strong and influential that it can feel really lonely and isolating to try to do it another way. So, you know, read the resources, feel more confident about your choices, get support in whatever way that looks like. And just really figure out what it is that you want for your own relationship with food, as opposed to what anybody else out there says it should be.
Yeah. Love that. Very, very well said. You sent me all of like your links and everything, and I'll put that in the show notes of this episode. But I was wondering if there's anything else going on that you wanted to plug or promote.
I think mainly I would just love for people to, if they're interested in, family feeding in that way, or interested in because they have kids or are thinking about having kids soon or anything, to join the Joyful Eating for Your Family Facebook group. That's a great resource to have. Like you said, I'm also on Instagram at Nicole Cruz RD. And I do have a bunch of free guides on my website that can get you started, or you can get them through like my Instagram bio. They can get you started in just kind of tapping into some of these things. So that's a great place to get some resources as well. And what else? Oh, and then I will be having my, I have like a, if sugar, this is very specific, but if sugar and sweets in general feel like a major battle. It's such a hot topic. When I talk to parents, so often I hear about sweets and vegetables. Those are the two things that just seem to hold so much energy and challenge. So I do have kind of like a mini course on sweets that I am about to make available. I just updated it and everything, and so I'm about to make that available. And so I can send you the link to that too. It's called Making
Okay,
Sense of
yay.
Sweets, and you can jump on the wait list so that you are aware of that, and it'll just be like a self-guided course plus a few group coaching calls to ask questions and things.
That sounds awesome. And I can attest, like I was saying at the beginning, these guides and resources Nicole has are great. So you guys should check them
Thank you.
out for sure. Yeah, well, it's been really lovely getting to chat with you today. Like I said, it's nice to get to meet and see the face behind Instagram pages and resources that I've been following for a while.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for having me on. It's great to get to connect and, like you said, to chat face to face for a bit.
Yeah, well, I hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thank you. You too.
Thank you for listening. Diet Culture is co-produced by myself and my brother, Nick Lewis. You can keep up with what's going on with Diet Culture on my Instagram page at Dietitian Danny Cast. If you prefer to watch rather than just listen, check us out on YouTube. And we always love ratings and reviews if you haven't done so already. Thank you so much for your support and can't wait to talk to you next week.